Thank you for listening to the CPA Trendlines podcast, a production of CPATrendlines.com, now available on iTunes.
And hi, everybody. Richard Rothstein from Rothstein Consulting, again for CPA Trendlines. Now, today, we have a real treat in this series. I'm talking with Todd Hockenberry of Top Line Results. Now, Todd doesn't own a CPA firm. He has no ties to the accountant, but here's the cool thing, okay? Todd co-wrote a book called Inbound Organization, where he talked about this great way of recruiting people called inbound recruiting. So we're going to talk to Todd a little bit about what he's seeing in the world and find out a little bit more about this great way, which, you know, I also subscribe to. I think it's really awesome, of helping, you know, helping companies get the most out of their recruiting efforts and you know, bang for their buck. So hi, Todd, how you doing?
Doing fantastic today. Thanks very much for having me.
Oh, it's a pleasure. Pleasure's all mine. Could you tell me a little bit about, you know, Top Line Results and what you guys do for your clients?
Sure. Top Line Results is an advisory and consulting firm, and we work with a lot of B2B companies, mainly in the manufacturing and industrial areas. And we help them grow using inbound principles, whether it's applied to marketing or sales or service, and even back office things like recruiting and culture and building an operating system for your company. And we really apply the ideas of inbound across the entire organization. That's really what the book's about. That's why it's called Inbound Organization.
Wow, that's so cool. Could you, before we kind of get into some of our more standard questions, could you tell us a little bit more about kind of that idea of inbound and maybe, I mean, define for our audience what that means and what it means specifically to recruiting?
Sure. Inbound is the idea that started kind of about 15 years ago. And the idea was that marketing was kind of broken and that our marketing had become annoying, right? I mean, we know it, right? The interruptive marketing, phone calls, spam, you know, people knocking on your door, television ads, radio ads, those are all interruptive, right? They interrupt what you're doing in terms of consuming content or just living your life. So an alternative grew, and it was really driven by the internet, obviously, was the idea that you could do attractive marketing. Essentially, you would be able to have marketing that people actually wanted to consume and be part of. They wanted to participate. So it started with content online, and it was clearly people were searching for answers, searching for helpful information. I'll use that word a lot, helpful, right? You want to remember that one, helpful, as opposed to things that are annoying, right? A self-absorbed ad driven by a marketer is annoying and it's not helpful. An article that answers my question, that addresses my concerns, that uses professional expertise and value is something that I enjoy. I like that. It's helping me, right? Mm-hmm. Think about now how easy it is to solve a problem, right? I was working on my washing machine last weekend. This is totally off topic, but it's interesting. I'm looking to fix my washing machine. So instead of calling up a repair guy or a repair company, I go online and say, how do I solve this problem? I find a video and within 5 minutes, I have an answer, right? So that's helpful. That's content that's shared, that's marketed, that's helpful to me, that makes me say, thank you very much. If I ever want to buy products or parts or whatever, I might look at their website again. So the idea is starting to change. And we know this, we've seen this, we see this every day, right? Inbound is the idea that you create helpful, attractive marketing that brings people to you in a way that is natural, human, helpful, and not really annoying and making me want to hit delete or unsubscribe or make and mark you as spam. So that was the kind of trend that started it. And over the past 10 to 15 years, we've seen these ideas move to sales. Salespeople have changed and they've started to use content and they've started to be more helpful. And again, we have a lot of salespeople that aren't, but there's a lot more that are. And we're seeing these ideas kind of infiltrate all of the organization, because at the end of the day, if your prospects and customers want to deal with you in a certain way, and I promise you they want to deal with you in an inbound way, then everyone in your organization needs to be aligned around the idea that the way we go to market is an inbound way, right? That we're taking into account these principles and these desires of buyers. the book came from Dan and I meeting a few years ago at a conference in California. We were having breakfast, and Dan Tyer, our co-author, and we started talking about these topics. And it was funny because we realized we were both talking about the same things, that the inbound idea is not just a marketing thing anymore. It's really a business philosophy, and it applies to your whole company. Because if your marketing is inbound, but your sales isn't, or your service team is not, or your the way you run your back office or your business is not focused on customers first, being helpful, attracting them, creating content and resources that make their life easier, and not just push a product on them, it's gonna your marketing will fail. So it's become broader. So that's in a big sense, that's where the idea of inbound organization came from. What's interesting about inbound recruiting and the why these things apply is your buyers' changes are very, very similar to your employees' or prospective employees' changes in the way they view the world, right? Your employees are going to look at, or your prospective employees, candidates, are going to look for companies that are helpful, that have a good culture, that have a track record of taking care of their people. Remember I said that earlier, human first, they're very people-centric. Yeah. They're going to look for companies that are that match their values and their beliefs. They're going to look for companies that have a progressive organization in terms of opportunities to move forward, a healthy environment, right? That's what people are going to look for. They don't just look for a job. I mean, I'm old enough to be from the 80s when I first looked for my first job, you know, and I'm just like, well, how much are they paying and when can I start? You know, it was like, just give me a job and the boss is going to tell me what to do and I'm going to do my job and I'm going to shut up and be happy. And, that's not the way the world is anymore. And I've got a 21-year-old daughter who just graduated from college. And I promise you, she's looking on Glassdoor. She's asking LinkedIn connections about companies that she's talking to. And she cares about the culture of the company she's looking at. She cares about the product. She cares about the beliefs and the actions of the company. Those things matter a lot. And she's going to care a lot about what the day-to-day looks like. She's going to care a lot about what the environment is. And she will get to salary and benefits and vacation and things like that. But those aren't the determining factors. She would more than likely take less money to work somewhere if it fit all those other – checked all those other boxes. Right. So – and she's looking by looking at LinkedIn, Glassdoor, and lots of other places – I can tell you another one. If she goes on your website and your website looks like it was made in 1997 and the copyright date in the footer is 2003 and it's got, you know, it's clearly an old website, it's not going to leave a good impression with her as an employee. She's going to want to see, are you progressive? Are you thinking about how you present to the world? These are all really become, we haven't talked about anything in terms of, you know, the product or what you do. And again, if you're talking about professional services, it's even more important, right? It's even more important than more of a product-based company, because a professional service firm is, it's all about your people, right? It's about your culture. And, you know, if your culture is not an inbound healthy one, then how are you going to be able to deliver services at a high level in a way that's inbound, that's the way modern buyers want to consume them? And your employees know that, right? Yeah. Salespeople don't want to sell bad products. Salespeople don't want to deal with services that are poorly delivered. Anybody that works for you wants to work for a company they can be proud of and that makes their life easy. In the sense that, why would I want to deal with the headaches of a bad culture, toxic leadership, poor systems, no resources, right? Your employees and or your ex-employees are going to tell people about these things. They're going to share this information. It's going to be public. So it's part of your record, right? It's part of how the world views you. So these things are inbound, right? Paying attention to your Google business listing and the ratings and comments, paying attention to Glassdoor, paying attention to these kind of digital things. If you don't, then the rest of the world and your ex-employees are going to be the ones telling your prospects whether they should work for you. And again, from an inbound perspective, if you're not good at this, then you're going to by definition never talk to the best candidates. Yeah, they'll discount you.
Right. I'm struck by two things here. One is, you know, when you talk about inbounders in general, I feel like being an 80s kid, it feels to me like Saturday morning cartoons, but for grownups. Right. Like, so it's not the Transformers commercial, it's the Transformers show. you know, it's taking marketing that direction, but like maybe like in a grown up way.
Yeah. I mean, it's become, our expectations of what we buy have changed so radically, right?
Yeah.
I mean, think about what you buy on Amazon. This is a great example, right? Do you look at the reviews and the ratings for just about anything you buy?
Absolutely.
Of course you do. How much more would you do that for a job?
As much as I can.
Of course. And I'm looking at everything. I'm looking if I'm searching, do you have legal judgments out against you? Has anybody complained anywhere officially? I'm searching the internet. And again, if you don't know what the internet says about your company, as soon as you're done listening to this, go find out what the internet says about your company, because that's what your prospects and your prospective employees and your partners and anybody that you would want to work with is going to be looking at.
Yeah. And the second thing that made sense is kind of that overlap between like the how you build your company from a marketing perspective versus how that influences your recruiting. You know, I know I've worked on a few engagements here that are inbound recruiting with accounting firms, and I see that like there comes a point, you know, the marketing person is always there at those meetings, and there comes a point where I'm kind of like, you know, we should make this change because, by the way, it makes your other job, the rest of your job, easier. And I find myself saying that quite a bit to them, and I'm like, yeah, absolutely, we totally need to do that and leverage that both directions. An interesting, you know, interesting overlap there.
Well, Richard, smart consultants like you and your business that are working with people doing marketing and inbound sales, they're gonna have that conversation, and I know you do. You have that with your clients because at the end of the day, if I'm creating content and I'm building a website and I'm building a presence on social media, I want to attract the best people, right? It's the same principles. It's the same ideas. And if you're not doing it well, then again, I cannot emphasize this enough. If your website looks like it was built 12 years ago and it's never been touched, it's like somebody walking in your front office and a pile of dirt sitting on the front of your, you know, in the doorway, right? Yeah. Your glass is broken on your windows and your front desk has duct tape holding it together. It's the same thing. Would you do that in your office? You wouldn't. But I don't know why people do that on their websites and their online presence, but they do. That's why you and I have jobs.
That's fair. So I'm going to kind of get into some of our normal questions with you at this point.
We haven't gotten to our normal questions yet?
We haven't gotten to any of the normal questions. It's just been Todd Hockenberry awesomeness, like super bonus time. So how do you see people and how are you recommending your clients? How are you recommending they handled recruiting before COVID? I guess we did kind of answer that one. So I'll kind of just, are there any particular channels though that we kind of talked slightly about this, but are there any like favorite channels you have right now?
Well, you mentioned COVID. Let me talk about COVID real quick. Pandemics are accelerators, right? The trends that we're talking about have been drastically accelerated in the last 9 months. So this was already happening. It's just on steroids, right? People are getting jobs today that never meet their employers, right? They're doing it like we're doing it right now over Zoom. They're doing interviews. So it's all digital, right? That wouldn't have happened anywhere near as often a year ago. So this trend towards this idea of remote, digital, and having this kind of inbound connection is just accelerating. How we recommend people do this now is first and foremost, there's the internal and the external piece. The external piece is do your marketing well, show your company well. And again, I keep saying this, get your digital footprint in order. That's number one. Number two is look at your culture. And your culture isn't what you think it is, because I can't tell you how many CEOs and leaders I've talked to that said, oh, we have a great culture. And then you talk to their people and as you go through the organization, you realize that the culture isn't about the mission, right? Again, mission and culture are really intricately connected. And mission is about what you want to do and where you want to go and who you help and how you help them. Culture is about the environment you create to get there. So culture needs to support mission. Mission should guide the kind of culture you have. And too many people say, oh, well, we're customer centric. Who would tell you if you asked them and they weren't customer centric? You know what the first thing I do when they say that is I call them. Mm-hmm. I call their company, call the 800 number. And if I hear hit one for this, hit two for that, hit four for that, I'm just like, you're not customer centric. Because I asked the CEO, it's like, how do you feel when you call somebody and you get the phone mail tree, this or this call is being recorded for quality purpose garbage, right? We all hate that, but they still do it, but yet they hate it. So you're probably not as customer centric as you think. So you really need to get out of your own head, put yourself in their shoes, think about as a modern buyer, not somebody, and I'm in my 50s, I need to think about it like somebody in their 20s or 30s would think about it and say, am I really customer focused? Is this kind of culture that I've created, am I really doing everything I can do to take care of my customers? And I'd ask my customers, how are they, you know, what do you like about working with us? What don't you like working about us? And then you can start to get a gauge on your culture. But yeah, I mean, I'm turning this stuff back around because, you know, at the end of the day, your culture is not what you say you do, it's what you actually do. So I'm going to look at what they actually do and say, you know, that's not super healthy, or that's super not super customer oriented.
Yeah. So sometimes from the C-suite, you get the culture that they want to have, not who they actually are.
Oh, there's companies will say they're about a whole bunch of things, but when you really dig in, you know, is it about the CEO and founder's ego? Is it all about them making them look good or them making them money? I've been around a ton of companies that's really what was driving them. It had nothing to do with customers and nothing with delivering value. It was about, you know, the CEO's ego was more important than anything else. That's a tough one for a CEO that's a tough one to fix. Right. But that happens and happens fairly regularly. So again, there's some basic stuff, you know, you guys know it, right? Don't, you know, if you get a lot of turnover, are people, you know, is everybody running out the door as soon as the quitting time bell, that's not even a thing anymore, right? you know, are people doing extra? Are your customers, without soliciting it, giving you referrals and recommendations and saying nice things about you and giving you 5-star reviews? If they're not doing that, then it's a signal. You're probably not taking care of them as much as you should.
That's a very, very thoughtful answer there. Do you feel like, you know, when getting new recruits, I mean, that this kind of helps from a competitive landscape as well?
Oh, sure. I mean, they're going to look at your competitors. They're going to do all the things we just talked about and look at your competitors in the same way. So, the first one that they see makes them excited and says, hey, these guys have it going on. They're now the standard and you're going to get compared to them. So, you know, I'm not a huge fan of like taking talent from competitors. Can work, especially from a sales perspective, right? If you're talking about a competitor salesperson, right? What's the classic stuff is, oh, bring your book of business, bring your client list, bring, you know, I'm never a big fan of that because, again, I think about it from the customer's perspective. One day you're over here telling me this is the greatest thing since sliced bread. And the next day you call me and say, this is, well, which is it?
Right. Yeah, I'm always wary of that. Definitely.
So do I trust you now? I'm not sure if I trust you. So again, I'm going to go back and try to put everything from the customer's point of view and learn from your competitors. I'm not a big fan of copying competitors. Do something a little different. I learn from my customers. I would spend a whole lot more time worrying about my customers than I would my competitors. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, that's interesting. So what do you feel like? I mean, I know you said it was an accelerant, but are there any specific changes you've kind of seen to the inbound organizationally, you know, post-COVID?
Yeah, the tools, the technology, and the mindset are all rapidly moving towards this model. When you think about the personalization of interactions, people are going to want to personalize job experience too. And maybe that's the biggest thing is this idea of experience that there's a buyer experience that Inbound talks about where a buyer goes through stages. They research a problem, they consider the alternatives, they qualify them, they narrow it down and they make a decision. And then there's this ongoing, am I successful? Am I getting the value I thought out of this process? And people that are being recruited do the same thing. Right? They're going to go through a similar experience, and all parts of it need to really be designed and thought through. When we were working on the book, I spoke with Dan and I interviewed some people that work for HubSpot, which is a fantastic company. Mm-hmm. And we were asking them about their recruiting process. And this is where I was a little slow sometimes, but this is where the light bulb went off for me, where they said, oh yeah, when we want to bring somebody in for an interview, let's just talk about that. It's all designed. Where they come in, where they sit, the experience of them walking in the door, who they talk to, how long we take to get to them, the conference room they're in, the entire experience of going through that interview is designed to make them feel like they want to work here, that this is a positive place to be. Think about the job interviews you may have gone on, Richard. I know I went on a number of them many years ago, and it was always classic. I'm going to go sit in the waiting room. And I'm going to be like at the doctor's office, and maybe they're on time. Maybe they aren't. Nobody's going to talk to me. They're not going to give me anything to do or to think about or review or anything interesting to do while I wait. I'm just going to sit there and wait. And then I'm going to go in and I'm going to sit in a boring conference room, right? I mean, you know the routine, right?
Yeah.
It's not a great experience, right? Design the experience so the person that you're recruiting walks out and goes, holy cow, that's different. That's a whole different process of interviewing than I've ever been through before. And what would really be the kind of feedback that would tell you that's a good experience is that if they didn't take the job or you didn't hire them, they still gave you good reviews on Glassdoor. They still said nice things about you, or they recommended other people to work for you because they were like, they didn't pick me. It wasn't a good fit, but this is somebody you want to talk to, right? You can do that. You can create an experience for the recruit through the entire process from the first touch all the way through hiring. And then you need to take it on beyond that after you hire them. What's their first day look like, right? Did you expect them to show up? Are you organized? Is it a positive first day? Is it productive for them? Not just for you and not just for your HR people, not just for their supervisors, but was it a good experience for them? And did you leave a really good, deep, positive impression on their first day with them, right? Again, a lot of people, I mean, it's been a while since I actually took a new job, but I can remember kind of like walking the door and like, these people wouldn't even know I'm supposed to be here. Yeah. And too many experiences are like that for recruits, right? So the idea of this experience, that you can control that whole experience, and you can control it all. So you should control the entire recruiting experience and make it one that reflects well on your company, your people, and your culture.
That's great. What do you kind of expect to see in the recruiting situation to look like a year from now?
The things I'm seeing accelerating are again, the digital connections. And what's great about the digital connections is that you can expand this idea of referrals and recommendations. What would you rather have? Would you rather have a pile of resumes on your desk through monster.com? I don't even know if that's a thing anymore. That's how old I am. Monster.com was the way people used to get resumes to people. Or would you have rather promoted a job opening through your network of all your LinkedIn connections and all your connections through your other social media channels and said, here's what we're looking for. Here's the ideal candidate. Here's the persona, the type of person we really are looking for. Do you know anyone that fits this mold? The reason I know this is such a thing now is that I just did this with my daughter, right? Mm-hmm. She's looking, and I just happened to have somebody do exactly that thing for me through LinkedIn. And it was like, I was like, yeah, I do. I know somebody and she'd be perfect. Right. So now it's a one-to-one connection. Somebody I know got a referral from me. And again, I do this fairly regularly. So I would much rather have those direct connection referrals mm-hmm. than I would just the random off the street, somebody doing a search and saying, you know, sending out resume after resume after resume. I'd rather have a good fit. Right. So I want less candidates, but I want better candidates. And I think more and more people are going to move away from the listing, vomit, throw it out there to the whole world and help everybody. Hope we find somebody out of this giant pile of people that reply. And I'm going to narrow it down and say, I'm going to work in my network, in my ecosystem of my partners and my customers and my connections and try to find the best people. And then I'm going to try to use my network to filter it down and give me the best candidates. I think that's the trend that's happening fast.
Interesting. So with that, I think that kind of ties into the final question I asked everybody is what kind of advice you have for firms that are looking to hire right now?
Do what I just said. and fix your website, get rid of that stupid voicemail thing on your call in at your main company number. Be the company you want other people to work for, right? Be the kind of company people would be attracted to and want to line up and work for. The ideal situation is in an inbound world is your company is so attractive and such a great place to be that you are literally attracting the best candidates and they are reaching out to you saying, you know what, I'm really interested in your company. Is there an opportunity there, right? And it happens all the time in the inbound world. I see a lot.
Wow, that's so cool. Well, Todd, thank you so much for all your time with us today. It's been, I mean, for me, it's been some really great thought bombs to just really set off some great direction. So thank you so very much. And, and just thanks again.
My pleasure. Richard, thanks for having me. And real quick, my short plug here is I hope I was helpful first. I mean, being inbound, I'm going to help you with some ideas. I earn the opportunity to say this. Check out inboundorganization.com. That's where you can learn about our book. And if you like it, go to Amazon. We'd love to have you buy it and read it.
All right. Thanks. Yeah, as your co-author, Dan Tyer, says, always be helping.
That's correct.
Right. Take care.
Bye.
Thank you for listening to the CPA Trendlines podcast, a production of CPATrendlines.com, now available on iTunes. We hope you'll rate and review us wherever you find your podcasts to help other accountants find our show more easily. For more information, you can go to CPATrendlines.com.